last call for introductions. It is now time for a question period. The member from Prince Edward Hastings.
Thank you and good morning, Mr. Speaker. My question this morning is for the minister responsible for the Pan Am Games. Minister, in my hand I have the financial section of the TO 2015 bid book. Nowhere in this is there an actual line-by-line cost of the projects associated with the Pan Am and Parapan Games. Your ministry and TO 2015 officials keep promising that the projects are on budget and that they're on time, which is pretty easy to say when you don't provide a budget outlining the line-by-line for these costs. Your government really has no intention on being transparent, Minister. Minister, where's the publicly available TO 2015 budget so the taxpayers can actually see how much these games are going to cost them?
Minister responsible for the
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the member opposite for this opportunity to really talk about the great things that are happening in Ontario, especially the Pan Am Games that are taking place next year.
Thank you. Finish, please.
And as the member knows, these games are the most transparent games in the history of any sporting event in this country. In fact, these games, Mr. Speaker, these games are put under the Freedom of Information Act. You can access that information through an FOI. We've had two technical briefings. In fact, I think both critics in the past have attended, I think, one of them, but we have had two technical briefings. And we will go forward with another technical briefing very soon before the fall hits. And we're very proud of these games. And Mr. Speaker, I'll talk.
Thank you. Supplementary.
You're skating.
It's quite a statement, Mr. Speaker. I'm sure the media would love to see the budget. I know taxpayers would love to see the line-by-line budget. And, Minister, quite honestly, your excuses for the venues so far, when we're talking about the Tim Hortons Stadium, which is the new home of the Hamilton Tiger Cats, eventually, it was late. It's not on time. It's not on budget. But your excuse for why it was late was because of winter. Here's a news flash for you. We're building projects in Canada, and winter does happen here. Minister, in order to host these games, you had to sign over 25 different memorandums of understanding with new or retrofitted venues. In this bid book, it says that the venues are going to cost $75 million. We know that the Hamilton Stadium has cost over $100 million.
Question.
Will you commit? That's just one, by the way. Will you commit to tabling all the signed MOUs in the legislature so that taxpayers are on the
I stand, you sit. Minister.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. What the member opposite won't tell you is that we are $50 million under budget when it comes to our venues here in the province of Ontario. Thank you to Infrastructure Ontario for bringing us under budget. That's 10% under budget than what we originally. And you know what? If you want to get into details about venues, let me go through a few of these venues, Mr. Speaker. Today, I'm so proud to announce that the Aquatic Centre at Scarborough, the Scarborough's University of Toronto campus, is complete. It's officially being handed over, and it is complete. And in fact, Mr. Speaker, that was slated for $248.9 million. You know what the cost is? $205 million. So I want you to stand up and join the rest of us on this side of the House in Ontario and celebrate what we're doing when it comes to the Pan Am Games. Because it is the largest multi-sport games in the history of not only this city, not only this province, but this entire country, and you should be proud.
Thank you. Yeah. Supplementary. Be seated, please. Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, the tryouts for the Toronto cheerleading teams were last week. They were last week. There's no reason to cheer about these games, and everybody out there knows it. Minister, let me just remind you that your government lowballed the orange cost.
Order. Finish, please.
with the $200 million PowerPoint.
Minister, your government lowballed the cost of Orange. It took the Auditor General to get to the truth. You originally said the cost of the gas plant scandal was 5% of what the Auditor General showed the final cost as being. Is it going to take calling in the Auditor General to find out how much these games are actually going to cost? Because you're not being open and you're not being transparent in sharing the actual cost of the games. Are you going to stall?
Question.
Are you going to slap a final price tag on the games and then tell the people of Ontario that these games were on budget after it's too late to do anything about it?
Thank you.
Good question. Good.
Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, I have to say, we've had the most transparent games in the history of any sporting event in this entire country. We have had technical briefings on two occasions, and I think the opposition member who's responsible for the file before only attended one of the two. We will have another one, and I invite you to join me, but let's go through this list of other events and see where they are. Mr. Speaker, we have the athletic stadium at York University. It was originally budgeted for $52.9 million. I can report that the cost is $45.9 million, so that's under budget. Mr. Speaker, these guys across the opposition members will tell you when things are going bad, but they won't say when things are going good.
Never.
And these games are going well. We're under budget when it comes to our infrastructure. I think you should stand up and compliment this government for it.
Thank you. New question. Member from Dufferin-Caledon.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Education. Minister, a chart prepared by your own ministry shows huge discrepancies between the funds given to the 72 school boards across Ontario to assist students with special needs. In my own riding, the Upper Grand District School Board and the Peel Board of Ed both receive some of the lowest per funding for students at $365 and $339, compared to some boards receiving well over $1,000. Minister, we all understand that a student with a learning disability will need similar resources to succeed, regardless of where they live in Ontario. Can you please explain why there is such a massive variance in the resources allocated to students with special needs in different parts of the province?
Well, actually, no. Start the clock. The member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek and the member from Eglinton Loras will take their conversation somewhere else other than this house. Finish, please.
Yes, thank you very much. I'm very pleased to respond to the question. We are now spending $2.5 billion on special education in this province. And special education is relatively unique in our funding model in that boards must spend all the money allocated for special needs students on special education. In fact, the vast majority of that money, the biggest chunk of that money, is allocated on a per pupil basis. So that you count the number of pupils in Upper Grand and allocate a per pupil amount. It's known as SEPA, the Special Ed Per Pupil Amount. So the bulk of that $2.5 billion is on a per pupil basis.
Supplementary.
Minister, arguments like that don't hold water because Peel is getting $300 and there are boards that are getting $1,600. It's not fair. It's not equitable. Regardless of where you live in Ontario, you should appreciate, you should expect that your government will assist your child with a special need.
Absolutely.
The Libs have been in power for more than a decade, and it's time that you take responsibility for the students languishing on these wait lists. No amount of justification or talking or explanation can justify the current funding model where a school board is given $1,600 per student while others, like students in Dufferin and Peel region, receive less than 20% of that amount. Your budget doesn't address this inequity, and families are tired of being told there's no resources to help their son or daughter with a special need. When is this government going to admit there is a problem, and what steps are you taking to address the funding
inequity? Actually, the member has it wrong. The budget and the grants for students' needs do address this problem. which is that the high needs amount has in fact been a subject of concern. We struck a working group. The working group, composed of special needs and school administrators, folks from all over the province, suggested a new funding model for the high needs amount. And the budget this year, the grants for student needs, in fact, are implementing a gradual transition to a high needs funding amount, which, what I would point out, the chair of the Peel District School Board said is a great improvement and thanked us for implementing a new funding model for high needs amount for special education.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
You know, I don't think parents and children who need special needs are interested in a lecture. I think they're interested in some action. It's not in the budget. I've looked at it. You've talked about full-day learning. You've not talked about actually solving that inequity where certain boards get over five times what other boards get. Another waiting list that's plaguing children with special needs is access to assessment. As you know, a formal assessment is the key to receiving services students need to thrive. It gives them a legal right to services or a right to wait on another waiting list. People for Education's 2014 report on special education includes quotes from principals who mention a three-year wait for an assessment. I have parents calling my office. They have to make a choice between waiting 3 years for board assessments or paying for private assessments at a cost of $3,000. It's simply out of reach for most Ontario families. Will you address the wait time for assessments, the wait time for services, and funding inequities between boards?
Thank you, Minister. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister?
Yes, and I find it very surprising that the member opposite, having identified an issue which was a difficult allocation of the high needs amount, and saying, why don't you fix it, when we point out that we are in the process of fixing it and in fact are in the process of implementing a new model for high needs, then turns around and says, well, that doesn't matter, I don't care. We're doing exactly what the member asked us to do. And in fact, the Peel District School Board
has said
we are addressing the problem that we identified. So I don't know how on earth we make the member opposite happy if she identifies a problem and we're in fact fixing it. Thank you.
Thank you. Your question, the leader of the third party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Does the Premier think the LCBO headquarters and GM shares combined are worth $3.15 billion?
Minister of Finance.
No, Mr. Speaker, it's not.
Thank you. New question. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, the Premier's plan counts on at least $3.15 billion from assets, and so the LCBO headquarters and the GM shares are worth significant sums, but certainly not $3.15 billion, as the Finance Minister has just acknowledged. So the question is an obvious one. Where's the money coming from, Speaker?
So, Mr. Speaker, that's why we have Mr. Clark and the Council and doing their work, reviewing effectively and appropriately the values of our Crown corporations, our assets, and how we can. Basically, we're talking about looking at those products that the member just spoke about, real estate and shares and companies where we're not getting the most productivity and the best value for our taxpayer, to do an asset swap to find better ways to invest it. Would you rather have shares of GM that are there as a passive investor, or would you rather us build a subway?
Yep.
Do you want us to have a real estate holdings in downtown Toronto, or do you want us to build an LRT? Do you want us to have roads and bridges up in the north, or do you want us to hold on to real estate in Hamilton,
in your own
riding? We are trying to make it more productive and more effective for the people of this province, for the long term, and for our prosperity.
Final
Speaker, the Liberals are holding a blind auction where the public are the only ones who are being left in the dark.
That's right.
On the one hand, they've already been asking, have an asking price of $3.15 billion, Speaker, and on the other hand, they won't tell the public what's for sale. Is it the LCBO? Is it Hydro One? Apparently, no one will say, but someone's clearly done the math, Speaker. Why is the Premier and her finance minister refusing to tell Ontarians the whole story about their fire sale of public assets?
Mr. Speaker, we're not refusing to tell anything.
Okay.
We're actually trying to, we put it in the budget, we're making it clear that we're going to be reviewing assets, we're going to be reviewing the operations of our Crown corporations, we're going to ensure that we maximize its value and provide greater dividends for the province of Ontario and for the taxpayer. And the Council's principles are as follows. One, the public interest must remain paramount and protected. Decisions must be aligned to maximize value for Ontarians, and the decision process will remain transparent, professional, and independently validated. What we want is to ensure that we're maximizing the values of the operations of our assets and ensure that we do better than we've been. You could put your head in the sand and pretend that there's no need, but there is. There's always a requirement for us to do more and do better.
Thank you. New question, Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My next questions are to the Premier about Liberal promises, frankly. The Liberal plan is good news for auto insurance companies, but let's talk about what that means for families. Yesterday, the Minister of Finance refused to commit to this year's target for getting auto insurance rates under control. If the Liberals can't keep their target this year, the question is, can the Premier tell drivers whether they'll ever see the 15% savings in auto insurance rates?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And you know, the fact is that auto insurance rates, on average, are down more than 5%, Mr. Speaker. And the leader of the third party's own candidates made comments during the election that they were getting better auto rates, Mr. Speaker. The fact is, we are on track. We have committed to a 15% reduction. And had we been able to pass the legislation that would have taken further costs out of the system, Mr. Speaker, we would be farther along. But we will reintroduce that. Reintroduce that legislation, Mr. Speaker. But here, in terms of the impact of our budget on families, you know, I think that the leader of the third party knows perfectly well that personal support workers will receive more money in wages, Mr. Speaker, as a result of our budget. The families of personal support workers will be supported, Mr. Speaker. Child care modernization, Mr. Speaker, and investments in early learning will make an impact on people's lives, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, families are in fact wondering exactly what the Liberal plan does mean for them. There is a growing chorus, Speaker, of economists, of editorialists, of bond rating agencies who are raising red flags about the Liberals' ability to keep their promises and pay the bills. That puts important services in this province, Speaker, like health care and education, at risk. With this in mind, why does the Premier think now is the right time to open up new loopholes for CEOs to write off their luxury expenses in this province?
So, Mr. Speaker, here's what I think it's time for. It's time for us to get our budget passed so that we can move on implementing $2.5 billion in Jobs and Prosperity Fund over the next 10 years, Mr. Speaker, to help businesses like Ubisoft that I was at this morning with the Minister of Economic Development and Employment and with the member for Davenport, that has created 330 jobs, Mr. Speaker, since 2010 by partnering with government. I think it's time to invest $130 billion in public infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. I think it's time to invest $11.4 billion in hospital expansions and redevelopments. I think it's time to start developing a Made in Ontario retirement pension plan. It's time to increase the Ontario Child Benefit. It's time to invest $810 million in developmental services, Mr. Speaker. And it's time to expand low-income health benefits. All of that's in our budget, Mr. Speaker. It's time to implement those things.
Final supplementary.
Speaker, the Liberals promised to make the tough choices, but the bottom line is that this budget opens up new loopholes for CEOs, while people who work hard every day and play by the rules are finding that life is getting harder and harder instead of easier. Now, is that what the Premier had in mind, Speaker, when she said difficult choices have to be made? How exactly difficult was it for this Premier to choose CEOs over everyday families?
Well, Mr. Speaker, we clearly have not done that, and the leader of the third party knows that. What we have done is we have brought back a budget to this legislature that would put $50 million in place for a new local poverty reduction fund. Yeah, we've brought back a budget that, as I have said, would increase wages for personal support workers, would put new funding in place for long-term care homes, would support in vitro fertilization funding, would expand mental health and addictions, Mr. Speaker, would put in place a comprehensive Aboriginal Action Plan, Mr. Speaker, and would invest billions in retrofits in our schools, Mr. Speaker. That's what our budget has put forward, Mr. Speaker. Those are the things that we will implement. And I know that the leader of the third party understands that and is looking for every reason not to support our budget, Mr. Speaker. But there is a long, long list of reasons that she should be supporting this budget, Mr. Speaker.
New question, the member from Kitchener-Conestoga.
Yes, thanks. My question is to the Minister of Labour. Minister, the Labour Board recently dismissed the Region of Waterloo's appeal against a Carpenters Union certification bid. And you know what was the defining evidence was in that case? The Region fixed a toilet handle at an addiction centre and installed a sign at a bus station.
A toilet handle?
Now the Region is subject to the same labour rules as a private sector construction company. And as a result, the Region is now locked into a labour monopoly. Minister, nobody agrees the system is fair. They know it's broken. That's why they now want the government to live up to its word and seriously consider fixing the Labour Act. So, Minister, will you agree to work with me today to restore open tendering in the Region of Waterloo?
Good idea.
Thank you, Speaker, and I do thank the honourable member for the question. The OLRB has released its final decision in regards to the matter that they were dealing with the Carpenters Union and Waterloo. Mr. Speaker, as you know, the OLRB is an independent quasi-judicial tribunal that we use from time to time in this House. As such, it would be inappropriate for me to comment or to pass judgment on the decisions of the board. But however, it's important to note, Speaker, that if the municipality is unsatisfied with the board's decision, they're able to reapply for classification as a non-construction employer. It's that simple, Speaker. The municipality has rights to move ahead in the process, and I would expect that they would ascertain as to whether they will use those rights. We know that, for example, non-construction employer classification was granted to the Windsor-Essex Catholic District School Board and the Independent Electricity System Operator as examples of where organizations have used the rights that they have to get the decision
Thank
they
you.
Would like to see.
Supplementary.
Minister, that's a horrible answer to a question, especially when you come into the Region of Waterloo. They've already gone through the process, Minister. They've already gone through the process, and they lost. They lost. This isn't a political issue, because I can tell you it isn't for the thousands of qualified tradespeople who've been now prevented from working on publicly funded infrastructure in the community where they live, work, and pay taxes. This is an issue of fairness.
Doesn't seem fair to me.
That hard-working men and women in my region want to see the government fix. They don't want to see their elected representatives stand by and allow a loophole in the Labour Relations Act to bar them from working on the very infrastructure that their taxes pay for. Minister, wouldn't you agree that it's only fair to give all qualified tradespeople an equal opportunity to bid on public infrastructure?
Question. Thank you.
They just want to work.
Mr.
Thank you, Speaker. On this side of the House, we're very, very proud of our track record. We enjoy labour peace in the province of Ontario. About 97% of collective agreements are solved without any resort to strike or to job action at all. But you know, I'm not surprised that the member from Kitchener-Conestoga is unhappy with the OLRB's decision, because in fact what the parties did was they used the rules that were put in place by his party to reach this decision. This isn't something that was brought in by this government. This is something that was brought in by your government. And certainly, if you made a mistake along the way, I'm open to suggestions as to how that might be fixed. But you've got to remember that these are rules that you brought in. You asked the parties to apply those rules. This is a ruling that's been handed down. If you have suggestions as to how we might correct what you obviously think is a mistake of yours, we'd be very, very happy to look at it.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
To be able to trust our healthcare system and providers, when things go wrong, they want the help of an independent third party that they can trust. But this government refuses to listen to patients, to their family, and to healthcare workers. The Liberals' new patient ombudsman very clearly works for the healthcare system and reports to the minister. It will be perceived as bias by people who have lost faith in our healthcare system, abilities to
help
them.
Without portfolio.
Speaker, will the minister explain why truly independent oversight of our hospital and long-term care home is so unacceptable to this government?
Good question. Thank you, Minister of Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm glad to have another opportunity to say how excited I am about the proposed legislation that contains within it the creation of the position of the patient ombudsman. And, Mr. Speaker, it's not a position that looks across government in all sectors of society that are important to Ontarians. It's an individual who he or she will be solely responsible for looking at the health care sector, the needs of the patients, the clients, to make sure that individuals and the families are getting the best possible care that we can provide. And this is an individual that won't be housed within government, will be in an agency of government, the most appropriate one, I believe, Health Quality Ontario, at arm's length to the government, producing an annual report which will be made public, which will have, quite frankly, the powers that the ombudsman has as well. And the ombudsman, I should add, has oversight of Health Quality Ontario where this person resides.
Yeah, this is good news.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, the minister says that the ombudsman, patient ombudsman, will have the power of the ombudsman, but that's just not the case. The patient ombudsman, for example, does not accept complaints from family members or from NPP, does not accept complaints from ambulance services, health unit, or home for special care. Wow. It does not investigate decisions or recommendations. It needs a warrant or a consent to enter the facility, and it is not an independent officer of this assembly. Your decision is not based on evidence. It is not based on best practice. Why does the minister insist on saying the patient ombudsman is good enough for Ontarians when every other province and territories has ombudsman oversight of their health care system?
This is better.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm confident that we're actually doing something which is better than those other provinces and territories. It's an individual that's wholly focused on our health care system, and here's what we actually based the legislation on: the Ombudsman Act. We consulted with the Ombudsman on the creation of this position. Here's what the patient ombudsman will be able to do. We'll be able to investigate both in response to a complaint or initiate his or her own investigation. Yeah. Like the ombudsman, the patient ombudsman would have the ability to enter premises for the purpose of an investigation, ability to require the production of information and documents in connection with an investigation without entering a premise. Following an investigation, the patient ombudsman would be able to make recommendations not only to the CCAC, the LHINs, the hospital at issue, but also produce a report which is publicly available. And as I mentioned, the patient ombudsman that we consulted with for this position will have oversight of Health Quality Ontario, which is where this individual will reside.
Thank you. New question, member from Etobicoke North.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Ma question est pour le ministre du Développement.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Northern Development and Mines, the Honourable Michael Gravel.
McFuture. So I hope, Minister, that you will not give us a Trojan horse response.
Yes.
Speaker, our government has committed $1 billion for the development of the Ring of Fire. Realizing this project's full potential will not only bring thousands of jobs to the north, even Etobicoke North, but will also have a real positive impact across Ontario. That's why getting this project right is essential. Bringing together different proposals from First Nations communities, key mining companies, and different levels of government is needed to ensure this project's success. Speaker, my question is this. Can the minister please inform this House about the 60-day commitment to establish the Ring of Fire Development Corporation?
Question. Thank you. Minister of Northern Development.
Well,
and
a great question from the member from Etobicoke North. Thank you very much. Congratulations on your victory as well. And certainly, Mr. Speaker, our government is setting very tangible benchmarks so that we can drive smart, sustainable development forward in the Ring of Fire. And that is why, as of July the 3rd, when our government laid out our vision for during the throne speech, we also marked the beginning of our 60-day commitment to establish a development corporation. We've recognized, Speaker, the need to facilitate the creation of a business structure that can align interests and advance strategic infrastructure development in the Ring of Fire in a way that benefits all Ontarians. All of our partners will make crucial infrastructure decisions for the Ring of Fire and utilize the $1 billion we've created. ARC Alberta is going to continue to work with all of our partners to ensure that we meet that 60-day deadline. Our next benchmark in this great project's development. Thank you,
Thank
Mr.
You.
Speaker.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, for the update on the strategy and the initiatives. I think Ontarians appreciate and deserve a clear, sound strategic plan that will help realize this tremendous opportunity. Speaker, it was some degree of astonishment, however, when I realized the approach that the third party was taking regarding the Ring of Fire. The NDP seemed to demonstrate their inability, perhaps even their incapacity, to provide sound economic policy. Speaker, their recent platform allocated $0, nada, nothing, goose egg, butt kiss to the Ring of Fire. To be clear, it wasn't omitted from their platform. The NDP had one line item from the Ring of Fire, and it said zero. I'm encouraged, Speaker, that our financial commitment of $1 billion will help build the much-needed transportation infrastructure for this project. Speaker, the minister speaks about how benchmarking is important.
Question.
Would he please inform this House about how some of our government's milestones in this essential area of economic development are proceeding?
Minister.
Indeed, it is a great question and a very clear point about the very muddled platform commitment by the NDP, which wasn't really there. Speaker, this is a complex project, but with the right mechanisms and the right benchmarks we have, and we will keep this project moving forward. Certainly signing the historic landmark framework agreement with the with all nine Mattawa First Nations, the Premier Wynne was part of that, was a very significant achievement. Committing $1 billion to the Ring of Fire infrastructure is another example of how we are driving this great project forward. And may I say, Mr. Speaker, our 60-day commitment is but another example of our government's strategic approach to realize this multi-generational economic project. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question? The member from Thornhill.
Mr. Speaker, I have another question to the minister responsible for the Pan Am Games. On CFRB this past week, I heard the minister say that he expects GTHA municipalities to reduce traffic congestion by 20% in anticipation of the Pan Am Games next summer. Minister, you are punting responsibility to municipalities you've saddled with these games. By spending money on things like VIP lanes, you have lost an opportunity to invest in measures like synchronized traffic lights that would make a real impact on gridlock. Will the minister tell this House why he has chosen a Band-Aid solution over a plan to improve the lives of millions of Ontarians?
Good question.
Minister responsible for the Pan Am 2015 Pan Am.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate that. The Pan Am Games that are going to take place, it is Patchy's birthday today, so happy birthday, Patchy. It's his first birthday, so congratulations, Patchy. Pan Am Games are going to be an incredible event. It's going to be broadcast over 300 million people. We'll have over 300,000 people come into the GTA and the Golden Horseshoe to celebrate our athletes, not only from Ontario, but from right across Canada and from many countries in the Americas. And obviously, we're going to have to invest a lot of time and energy into making sure we get our transit right. And I know the minister responsible for transportation would like to weigh in on this this question, but we're going to really bring a lot of excitement here to the province of Ontario, and we're going to do everything we can to support them. And in fact, Mr. Speaker, we're going to have a lot of people from all around the world supporting us. And in fact, the last time we had dignitaries come down, I remember the party opposite turned their back on countries.
No. Supplementary.
Minister, it's hard to get excited about going to see a game when you know you're not going to make it to the game because you're sitting in gridlock. And I can't imagine how the athletes and the officials are going to feel. Your government decided to host these games with no regard for the impact on families and commuters. Now you're telling the GTHA municipalities they're on their own when it comes to gridlock for games you've said will be bigger than the Vancouver Olympics. You've chosen sky-high executive salaries over gridlock improvement measures. Minister, will you apologize to the GTHA taxpayers for the transportation nightmare that's yet to come?
Absolutely.
Minister?
Minister responsible for transportation.
Sir, transportation.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the, my colleague, the minister responsible for the Pan Am Games, for his opening response, but also for his outstanding work on this file. You know, it's interesting. Absolutely. I have the pleasure, Speaker, of being the neighbouring MPP to the member who's asking this question. As someone who's proud to represent a York Region riding, I think it's important to remember the Ministry of Transportation, working in conjunction with the other ministries that are affected, has a very strong and robust plan to make sure that we're able to move not only our regular commuters around the GTHA, but also the athletes, also all of the other volunteers and everyone else who is associated with the Pan Am Games, around the entire Games area in the most effective, efficient way possible. And I think, Speaker, with about a year left until the Games are actually taking place, it would make the most sense for the members on all sides of this House to work with us, to work with stakeholders, to work with municipalities and partners to make sure that these Games are as successful as they will be. I call on the member opposite to with us on this. Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker.
Your question, member from Welland.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing. Like many others, our province's mayors, regional chairs, and councillors are struggling to understand a fundamental contradiction in this budget. On one hand, they're told that the funding to municipalities is going up, and yet when you look at the actual budget, you find it includes annual cuts of 6% per year to most ministries, in a group that includes municipal affairs and housing. Speaker, the government cannot giveth and taketh away at the same time. Will the minister come clean and tell municipalities how much their programs will be cut?
Thank you. Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing.
Well, that's a great question, sure. I mean, Mr. Speaker, we on this side of the House pride ourselves in the relationship we've been able to develop with the 444 municipalities across Ontario.
Indeed.
We continue to meet our uploading schedule, which neither of the other parties would commit to in the last election.
That's true.
Which is important to our municipal leaders.
Yep.
But most importantly of all, we continue to dialogue with our partners at every opportunity. Including, by the way, I'm pleased to stand in this House today, Mr. Speaker, say the first thing I'm going to do as the new minister is a tour I'm calling the Building Bridges Tour. And we're going across Ontario to consult over and above the AMO consultations on issues of importance to our municipal partners.
Excellent.
And in an effort to find how we could work more even more effectively together.
Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, Table 2.19 on page 244 of the budget says something different.
Yeah.
Mr. Speaker, as the government decides how to cut 6% each year for 3 years, slashing budgets by a total of $3 billion per year, history shows that municipalities are often an easy target. As Brock University professor David Siegel pointed out yesterday, municipalities should be very worried with this budget. Almost 20 years ago, Mike Harris figured out that if he cut transfers to municipalities, forcing deep cuts to municipal programs, municipalities took the blame, not the province. And municipalities are still suffering those consequences. Mr. Speaker, will the minister please tell us how much of the $3 billion in cuts will be going to municipalities?
Well, Mr. Speaker, we're continuing with the uploading, as all members of this House should know, and as our municipal partners expect and appreciate. We have a memorandum of understanding with the 444 municipalities, which they signed on to, which defines the timing of the upload and how that's handled. They're happy with that. We have since 2014, in fact, provided a combined benefit of over $2 billion to municipalities. That's over three times the level that was in place in 2003. I think we've got a really good record and a good relationship with the municipalities, and I can pledge to the members of this House that that relationship will continue to improve under this government.
Your question, the member from Greenbrier-Prescott-Russell.
Thank you very much, Speaker. It's great to be back. My question is for the Associate Minister of Health with responsibility for long-term care and wellness, and I'd like to congratulate you on your appointment to Cabinet. Speaker, finally it's summer here in Ontario, and we're spending a lot more time outdoors, especially after that long, harsh winter that we just experienced. And now many families in my riding of Glengarry-Prescott-Russell are spending their weekends at the cottage, they're hiking or biking across our beautiful countryside, or they're just finding a beach to play on or just relax on. Or maybe they're just relaxing at home. Speaker, being outdoors can and should be fun, but it also carries some risks. Families in GPR and across this province are wondering what they can do to protect their kids. Through you, Speaker, could the minister tell this House how families can enjoy the sun while staying safe?
Thank you, Minister, Associate Minister of Long-Term Care and Health, responsible
Thank
for wellness.
Thank you, Speaker, and thanks to the very hard-working member for Glengarry-Prescott-Russell. Speaker, I want to start by saying how pleased I am that his constituents are out there enjoying the summer and being active, and I hope that he will be able to join them soon. Our government is committed to keeping Ontarians healthy, and, Speaker, there is no better way to stay healthy than to be active and fit. And there's no better time in a cold country like ours to stay active and fit than in the summer. So I urge all Ontarians to get out there and enjoy the great outdoors, canoe, go hiking, go swimming. And this is especially important for our kids because we know as parents and grandparents intuitively that our kids are not as active as they should be. In fact, studies show that our kids are spending 62% of their time inactive, and we must do everything we can to get them active. But it's really important that they stay safe, and that's why we urge them to use helmets.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for that comprehensive and thoughtful answer. Speaker, with the growing problem of childhood obesity, I know how important it is for our kids to get out and play and exercise, whether it's exploring a park, participating in sports, or swimming in a pond or a pool or a lake. We should all be encouraging our children to be exploring Ontario's great outdoors. Speaker, I know some people, they love the rain, and so do I, but the minister spoke about protecting our kids from skin cancer. I know that's something that parents actually worry about. They make sure their children are using sunscreen, wearing light clothing to protect the skin or from the sun and its harmful ultraviolet rays. But the sun isn't the only source of danger, Speaker. Through you, could the minister inform the House what else is the government doing to protect our children from skin cancer?
Thank you, Minister.
And thank you, Speaker. And the member for Glengarry-Prescott-Russell is absolutely right. There's more than one way to increase one's chances of getting skin cancer. Tanning bed usage in particular presents a particular risk, especially for our young. The International Agency for Research on Cancer has shown the risk of developing skin cancer increases by 75% when tanning beds are used before the age of 35. And that's why our government took action, passing legislation in October 2013 that will prevent young people from using tanning beds in Ontario. This came into effect, I'm happy to say, on May 1st of this year. And this was very timely because previously tanning bed use has been increased
increasing, more than doubling between 2006 and 2012 for grade 11 and grade 12
Answer.
Students. So, Speaker, now that we have this legislation, it's going to protect our kids from exposure to artificial ultraviolet radiation in tanning beds. I'm just going
to
ask all of us to have a safe summer.
Hear, hear.
Thank you. New question? The Leader of Her Majesty's Royal Opposition.
Minister of Health. Minister, over 3 years ago, I first stood in this House to raise an important issue about the discrepancy between how hospices are funded in Ontario, and I've since raised this issue with your government several times, and yet nothing seems to be happening. If you look at my riding, the North End Hospice receives funding from their LHIN, while the South End Hospice has been told that the LHINs don't fund residential hospices at all. Minister, hospices are there for those that require treatment at the end stages of life. The alternative for many people is to stay in the hospital at a much higher cost. In fact, the cost can be upwards of 10 times more expensive. An intensive care bed, as you know, averages close to $3,000 per day in hospital, while a hospice bed averages between $300 to $500. Minister, you have a clear opportunity to save taxpayers some money by supporting hospices across the province. Will you do that?
Thank you. Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And Mr. Speaker, we do support hospices across this province. In fact, we were the first government to invest in hospices, and we want to be sure that at this important moment in an individual's and their families and friends' life, that Ontarians have dignity through their final days. And we've now committed to a palliative and end-of-life strategy, and myself, along with the Associate Minister, will be working on that as we go forward. It was referenced in our platform as part of this plan. In fact, Mr. Speaker, we're committing to funding 20 more hospices across the province, almost doubling the number of people in Ontario who will have access to this high-quality end-of-life care. And it's important. It builds on an earlier strategy or end-of-life strategy from 2005, which at that time was a $115 million program to provide that dignity and that important support, that quality of health care to those individuals who so badly and so importantly deserve it.
That's right.
Supplementary.
Well, thank you for that answer. And Minister, you might want to adjust your number. I think it's 22 of the 35 hospices that actually receives nothing from government. And the 13 that do, they receive limited funding just for the nursing and personal support costs. So all of the capital, as you know, is fundraised by the local community. And in fact, I wish you'd talk to the Central LHIN, because Matthews House Hospice in Alliston runs 4 beds. They run completely without funding at all from the government, one of the 22. And the attitude that the LHIN has taken there is, how dare you go ahead and build a hospice and not have government approval ahead of time or government funding in place? What a horrible attitude that the ministry has in terms of, they should be thanking the people for raising millions of dollars, for putting the 4 beds in place, and for covering the up to $650,000 a year operating costs. And 80 people have gone through there. Average length of stay is 10 days. According to the formula, that's $2 million you save of healthcare dollars by supporting hospice. So will you support Matthews House?
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member opposite. In fact, he's making a good argument for supporting what we've proposed in the budget and our platform, which is developing a specific palliative and end-of-life strategy across the province. Yes. It's important that not only the system works better, but we want an overarching provincial policy framework when it comes to this end-of-life care. It's so important that we not do it. I'm not suggesting in this instance this is the case, but it can't be on an ad hoc basis. It needs to be very proactive. It needs to engage members of the community. It needs to have a provincial policy, which is the foundation of how we engage individuals and support. But we are. The reality is, Mr. Speaker, we're investing significantly more money. It's in our platform. We'll be finding ways to implement that going ahead, and we're going to be basing in part by a very important working group that was set up just last December,
a
residential hospice working group, which is consulting widely and is going to be providing us with the recommendations that we need to develop that important strategy for residential hospices as well as the other palliative care.
A new question, the member from Melbourne, Manitoulin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Good morning to you. And you should try to smile a little bit more, Mr. Speaker. It's not becoming of you to having that long pout on you.
Only the members can make me smile.
My question is directed to the Minister of Northern Development and Mines. Minister, your government promised during the election to establish a Ring of Fire Development Corporation within 60 days of assuming government. Just like you promised during the election that you would go ahead and invest $1 billion into the Ring of Fire, with or without a commitment from the federal government to match the funds. Even though your budget said that the $1 billion was contingent on the feds buying in. Well, Minister, which is it? Will you go ahead and invest $1 billion into the Ring of Fire, regardless of whether the feds sign on or not? The people of Northern Ontario deserve to know.
Thank you.
Well, I appreciate the question, Mr. Speaker, and indeed we have been very clear. The Premier was very clear during the campaign, and we're very clear now that the $1 billion commitment is indeed locked in place. We are going to move forward with this project. We've made a number of significant commitments, including moving forward with our 60-day commitment in terms of forming a development corporation. But that is not to say, Mr. Speaker, that we should not be putting pressure on, expecting the federal government to match our $1 billion commitment. The fact is that we want to realize the full potential of this extraordinary project, which includes a community access that indeed I would call on all members of the opposition, but certainly those on the official opposition side, to support our call on the federal government to match our dollars. But our commitment is in place, as is our commitment to move forward on the Development Corporation and the great work that we're doing with First Nations, particularly the Mattawa First Nations. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Once again, to the Minister of Northern Development Mines. I'm glad to hear the Minister now knows when his government's 60-day commitment to the creating the Ring of Fire Development Corporation begins. Yesterday, the Minister confessed he wasn't sure when the 60-day guarantee actually begins. He admitted he wasn't clear whether it's 60 days from being sworn in as Minister or 60 days from the throne speech. The minister then went on to say that this development corporation would be set up by the end of the summer. I have been asking for a briefing on this plan, but have been told it was premature. Will you commit to a date when the people of the North will see a development corporation up and running?
Question.
Minister, it's day 14. Tick, tick, tick.
Well, thank you very much, and again, I appreciate the question, although it is coming a little bit late in question period. We confirmed earlier in question period that indeed on July the 3rd was when the clock starts ticking, so to speak, towards the 60-day deadline, and we are going to meet that commitment, work with our partners to meet that commitment. And but it's a little ironic, coming from a party that during the campaign put in their platform support for the Ring of Fire, and work with that platform commitment was $0. So, I mean, for you to be speaking about us not being sure about deadlines or timelines, we're committed to the $1 billion. We call on the federal government to match those dollars. We're committed to our 60-day establishment of the Ring of Fire Development Corporation as of July the 3rd. It started that date, that timing. And indeed, we're committed to continue to work extremely closely with the Mattawa First Nations in terms of the further negotiations on regional process with the Ring of Fire. This is a great, exciting project. We need the support of everyone in the legislature to make this project happen.
New question, the member from Etobicoke Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question today is for the Minister responsible for Seniors Affairs. Mr. Speaker, as many of us in this legislature know, the number of seniors in Ontario is growing at a significant rate. And in fact, the number of seniors over 65 is projected to double by the year 2036. This shift in demographics offers opportunities, but it also offers challenges. In my own riding of Etobicoke Centre, we have one of the largest proportions of seniors of any riding in Ontario, so the services that our government provides are critically important, not only to seniors, but to their families in the community. Many of the seniors I have spoken to in Etobicoke Centre have asked where they can find more information about the services available to them, whether they be for recreational activities, lifelong learning possibilities, health care options, to help improve their daily quality of life. Would the minister explain how this government is helping seniors to access the information they need to continue to be active members of their communities?
Good question. Minister responsible for seniors affairs.
Mr. Speaker, the first chance I have to congratulate you on your reappointment. And I also wish you a very healthy and long life, for I know that if I know you want to smile, but it is because at the end of your term, Speaker, you will be the longest serving Speaker of the House, and I have to say congratulations on that too. So the longest member. As well, Speaker, I want to congratulate the wonderful people of Etobicoke Centre for electing such an energetic representative, and I know that he will serve the people of Etobicoke very, very well. Speaker, we know that we have a lot of seniors today, and we're going to have a lot of seniors tomorrow. We don't have to go as far as 2036. We need to look at 2016-17 to know that we will have more seniors over the age of 65 than under the age of 14. We have the Guide to Programs for Senior Speaker, which is a wonderful document, and I will add to it on my supplementary.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for that response. I know the guide that the Minister refers to covers a range of topics. I also know it's covered, it's written in a variety of languages to make it as accessible as possible. I think it's important that it get into the hands of people in our community in Etobicoke Centre and across Ontario. Can the minister please take his time in the supplementary to expand on what's in that guide? Because I think this would be to the benefit of my constituents in Etobicoke Centre, that they understand what's contained in it and to communities across Ontario.
Thank you. Minister.
I have to say thank you to the member, because he's on top of a very important issue that is also an issue important to the people of Etobicoke Centre. The guide in new format, it's a very user-friendly speaker, and on top of the English and French languages, thanks to the wonderful work of the Ontario Senior Secretariat, we have managed to produce and deliver, make it available in also another 14 languages, including Arabic, Chinese, Farsi, Gujarati, Italian, Korean, Polish, Portuguese, Punjabi, Russian, Spanish, Tamil, Urdu, and Vietnamese. Speaker, the guide is extremely well received, and it contains a lot about information about active living, caregiving, transportation, housing, and a lot more. It also includes a very key contact section with phone numbers which seniors can avail themselves. Speaker, this is one of the plans, but we will continue to make Ontario the best place where seniors can age in. Thank you.
Thank you. Question, the member from Central York. Not Central.
Thank you. My question is to the Premier. Premier, why is Ontario the only province to believe that the creation of a provincial pension plan is the best way for people to save for retirement? No other province or government thinks this is a good idea. Prince Edward Island is the latest province to back out of supporting your proposed Ontario retirement pension plan. Premier, at a time when businesses and families are struggling to stay afloat, why are you increasing payroll taxes and decreasing take-home pay?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I know that the Associate Minister responsible for the Ontario Retirement Pension Plan will want to speak to the supplementary, but I really need to say that it is it's very important that the member opposite understand, and I think she does, that our first choice all along would have been to have had the Canada Pension Plan enhanced. And we agree with provinces across the country that that is what should have happened. But the federal government, Stephen Harper, would not engage in that conversation, Mr. Speaker. He said that he wasn't interested. He did not want to do what every province across the country knows, Mr. Speaker, which is to negotiate a new and enhanced Canada Pension Plan. So, you know, if the member opposite has a way into the hearts of the federal government, her federal cousins, we would be more than happy to work with the federal government. But in the absence of that leadership, Mr. Speaker, we're going to stand up for retirement security of the people of Ontario.
Yes, I would just say that the federal government understands how to answer the question about increasing payroll taxes and decreasing take-home pay. The Canadian Federation of Independent Business says the new pension will hurt small and medium-sized businesses that simply cannot afford to make the employer contributions, and says that this plan will kill, not create, jobs. Ontario is the only province moving forward with this job-killing plan. Why are you making it harder for Ontario businesses and families to survive?
Good question.
Thank you, Speaker. And I would like to thank the member opposite for the question and congratulate her on her critic role for pensions. And you've asked a very important question of why. why do we need to create a Made in Ontario retirement pension plan?
Here,
and the simple fact of the matter is people are not saving enough for retirement, and we cannot put our population at risk by not taking action now. The fact of the matter is CPP is inadequate to meet the needs of retirees, at capping out at $12,500. And in fact, the average in Ontario is $6,800, and that is not enough income to sustain people. The fact of the matter is two-thirds of people are without a workplace-based pension plan, so those means are not enough as well. So we are moving forward in Ontario and providing an Ontario retirement pension plan so people can retire with adequate income security.
Yeah.
New question, the member from Niagara Falls.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Education. Minister, on Tuesday, the minister said she was delighted that they started to talk to boards about how they can make the use of school space. The members of the local community group, CARE, have a plan to work with the not-for-profits, groups like the Boys and Girls Club and the United Way, to create a new community hub and to keep their school open. Will the minister be delighted to listen to the community of Niagara on the Lake and ensure that this government invests in keeping Parliament Oak School open?
Good question. Thank you. Minister of Education.
Yes, and I think we need to back up a little bit. Because what I think the member is obliquely asking me is, will I overturn a decision by the board to close the school? And in fact, I have no legal authority to overturn a decision by a board to close a school. It is the fact that during NDP government, during PC government, during Liberal government, the Education Act has always given the local school board the exclusive authority over the ability to close a school. So if what he's asking me is, do I have the authority to overturn a decision that has already been made, the answer is actually no.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Minister, in your own budget, it says that the government will recognize the importance of schools in small communities. But at the same time, your budget seems to focus on a plan to close schools more than anything else. This budget lays out a specific plan to use $750 million to close schools, but doesn't have a program to keep them open. Will the minister promise to take action on the importance of small community schools and set aside a committed fund to keep schools open like Parliament Oak?
Thank you, Minister.
That's a different question, because in fact our budget does have in it a dedicated fund for community use of schools, but that is a fund that would be based on application only. The school board would have to apply to the government for that community use as part of a business plan. It is not intended to suddenly give me the authority to overturn. But certainly, if a board comes forward and says, we have a plan here that is a plan to transition us to community use of a particular building, then absolutely there is funding in the budget to engage in that conversation. But the board needs to approach the ministry with that as part of their plan.
Thank you. Point of order, the Premier.
Point of order. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, it came to my attention earlier this week that one of the respected members of the press gallery, Richard Brennan, celebrated his 40th wedding anniversary. He and Vicky celebrated their 40th wedding anniversary on We want to collectively
formally congratulate Richard and Vicky Brennan, who were married on July 13, 1974, in Ingersoll, Ontario. They have two children, Andrew and Kelly, and Kelly was married just a couple of days after the election, Mr. Speaker. Congratulations to her. Two grandkids, Mason and Audrey. They met in Ingersoll. They had their first date at a Christmas party in 1972. He worked at the paper, and she worked at the bank. And I just want to say that all of us, we want to especially congratulate Vicky for her perseverance.
The member from Algona, Manitoulin, asked me if there was a reason for me to smile. This is it, and it's for Vicky. I have to say that's not a point of order, but I'm sure that all of us share the joy of Richard and Vicky. We have a deferred vote on the motion of second reading of Bill 14, an act to implement budget measures and an act to amend various acts. Call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bell. Would all members take their seats, please? Would all members take their seats, please? On July 16th, Mr. Nackvi moves second reading of Bill 14. All those in favor, please rise one at a time, be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Nackvi.
Mr. Nackvi.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayeur.
Madame Mayeur.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Nadu Harris.
Ms. Nadu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. Elliott.
Mrs. Elliott.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Madame Gélinas.
Madame Gélinas.
Mr. Tavins.
Mr. Tavins.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Mr. Cimino.
Mr. Cimino.
Ms. French.
Ms. French. The ayes are 56, the nays are 36.
The ayes being 56 and the nays being 36, I declare the motion carried.
The bill, deuxième lecture, projet de loi.
Pursuant to the order of the House dated July 16th, this bill is referred to the Standing Committee on Finance and Economic Affairs. There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 1 p.m. this afternoon.